Hi, everyone. So happy to be here with you today. Truly love this community and everything you are striving for, which is more health, more peace, more confidence, being a better you, right? When I tell you that you can learn these things and apply them, I truly mean it. Today, I'm going to be talking about leptin resistance and how to combat it. This is a perfect fit for the kind of people who I typically see in the clinic dealing with appetite issues. Right? So when we talk about leptin resistance, we're talking about appetite issues because leptin is a hormone directly involved in controlling your appetite. And we're going to talk about this. And if you never heard about this, leptin resistance is going to be a hot topic in the future, and it's just as common as insulin resistance. So we need to be aware. So before we talk about this and get started, I want to tell you about what's going on here in the Nurse Doza Clinic, the actual physical clinic we have here in Austin, Texas. I work here 4 days a week. I see clients here. One of my favorite things to do for clients is order lab work for them. When I order lab work, I can get to the root cause of what's going on. A lot of people will order labs when they're trying to lose weight, a woman who's had just had a hysterectomy, or a person who's been dealing with low energy. There's numerous reasons to have labs done, but whenever you have your labs done with me, one of the best things about it is I review them in detail with you and I come up with a plan based off your lab results. We can even check your labs again in the future to see if we made a big difference. So if you're interested in this or you have old labs you want to share with me already, go to nursedoza.com and book your consult with me today. All right, let's get into this and let's change some lives. Class is in session. Leptin. I've been waiting for this podcast for a while. Leptin is a hormone that I have been studying for years, and you might not have heard about this just yet, but it is going to be very popular here in the next few years. And as we embark on what leptin is, just understand it's a hormone. Okay, so any hormone that goes into a dysfunction in the body, it affects other hormones. So when a woman, for example, will come in and do labs with me, they say, I can't lose weight. I want to figure out what's going on. Maybe it's hormone related. It's usually how the conversation starts. And I say, yeah, well, which hormone is it? And they look at me like I'm crazy. Like, I don't know. That's where, you know, you're coming in. And I say, well, here's the thing. We got to figure out which hormones it could be, because if you're having trouble with leptin or another hormone, it's all going to be affected and it's all going to affect one another. Leptin is a hormone that comes from your fat cells. And the first thing you need to know about leptin and leptin resistance is that it's just as common as insulin resistance. Insulin resistance, which is found in type 2 diabetes, insulin resistance affects a lot of people. In the United States, 1 in 3 people are pre-diabetic or insulin resistant, which means 1 in 3 people in the United States are also leptin resistant. And leptin is a hormone that usually is increased in weight gain. It's usually increased with insulin resistance, and it's usually increased when someone with diabetes. Leptin resistance will occur as you're developing insulin resistance. So let me walk you through the scenario. Whenever we decide to eat, we eat based off of the chemical signals in our body that are telling us whether we're hungry or whether we're full. The term fasted versus fed is usually the terminology that we use when we talk about our metabolism. Metabolism is energy. It's how we use energy, how we break it down, and how we function every day. Leptin is directly involved in our metabolism, just like insulin is directly involved in our metabolism. And when someone has a problem with their metabolism, let's say it's weight gain, let's say it's low energy, let's say it's hormonal problems, let's say it's PCOS, which is all very common with insulin resistance, you will have leptin resistance. Leptin comes from inflamed fat cells when people are increasing their insulin too much. So when you think about a 20-year-old who's eating fast food, maybe they're kind of skinny at first, but if they do it for 20 years and they don't take care of themselves, they're going to gain weight, right? Over that 20-year period of not taking care of yourself or not eating the right food, insulin resistance starts to build. When you eat food, it increases your blood sugar. With highly processed foods, especially breads and sugars, it increases your blood sugar a lot, which will then increase your insulin, which if you're interested in more knowing more about insulin, go check out our School of Doza podcast, Insulin Resistance, The Silent Killer. And with insulin increasing for 10 to 15 years, science has shown that insulin resistance occurs 10 to 15 years before the diagnosis of diabetes occurs. So it's happening in your 20s and 30s when you're eating junk food. Even a little bit of DoorDash here and there will contribute to this. While you're increasing your blood sugar, you're increasing your insulin, you keep doing it too much, your body is reluctant to release any more insulin after a while. The term insulin resistance comes from the idea that your body's pancreas is reluctant to release any more circulating insulin because you've already used up a bunch because you ate a bunch of DoorDash and fast food in your 20s and 30s, and you might live to 30, I mean, you might live to your 70s or 80s, which means your pancreas needs to make more insulin when you're older. When you run out of insulin, it's like when a woman runs out of eggs in menopause. You don't have any more. And so medicine says you need to inject yourself with insulin shots, okay? So insulin resistance is building the entire time before diabetes happens. Leptin resistance is also building the entire time too. When you spike your insulin, you spike your leptin. When you spike your insulin, you release your insulin from your pancreas, your fat cells respond. Remember, in your metabolism, just like with your hormones, not one hormone is going to be affected. So if you have insulin problems, it's not the only hormone affected. You definitely have leptin resistance. So leptin resistance will be triggered from your fat cells. And what's fascinating about it is your fat cells, like the same fat cells that you're trying to lose because you gained weight in them, your fat cells are an organ. And your fat cells in your belly are an organ to the point where they make hormones. They make leptin. Your fat cells around your belly make leptin. The fat cells around your chest make leptin. The fat cells on the inner part of your thighs and under your chin make leptin. Leptin is not very protective. Okay? It's a pro-inflammatory hormone. Science shows that little leptin at first actually is good for you because what it does is it suppresses your appetite. Remember, if you first eat, you're going to, no matter what it is, a burger, fries, a piece of lettuce, you increase your blood glucose a little bit because all macronutrients, fats, proteins, and carbs all wind up turning into blood glucose. Trust me, they're all interchanged. So all of that is going to increase your insulin, and insulin's the Uber driver that takes all those macronutrients and stores them in places like the liver, your fat cells, your muscles, and your brain. Now, when you have high amounts of blood sugar, you have high amounts of insulin. This could happen after your first meal. It could happen after your first DoorDash meal. It could be happening after a late night meal. Leptin's getting released from your fat cells. Doesn't matter if it was a tiny meal or a big meal. If it was a late night meal, it was a morning meal, leptin got released because leptin's main job coming from your fat cells is what? Suppress your appetite. When you suppress your appetite, you're full. Right? Why would your body want to suppress your appetite? Because you just ate. Right? I ate the DoorDash. I ate the fast food drive-through. My leptin is going up immediately after I eat, just like the insulin's going up immediately after I eat. Insulin goes up. The brain then signals the fat cells to release the leptin. Leptin then goes to the brain in the hypothalamus, and it tells the brain, stop eating. Put the fork down. That's what leptin does. So just like insulin resistance, if we have leptin resistance, imagine that signal coming from your fat cells that's going to your brain to tell you to stop eating. Imagine with leptin resistance, there's a lot of signals that have been sent up from the fat cell to the brain over the last 20 years, and your body is saying, you don't get the hint, do you? You keep eating when you're not hungry, and we have to keep releasing this leptin to go to your brain to tell you to put the fork down and stop eating, but you don't hear the signal and you miss it. So when somebody misses the signal, they develop leptin resistance. And here's what's really fascinating about this. Someone that has insulin resistance, the studies show, once again, you have leptin resistance. Well, imagine leptin resistance means you don't have an appetite ever. Like that's what it means. So a person who's gained weight, let's call it obesity. Call it being a little overweight, right? Obesity, leptin resistance, and insulin resistance are interrelated. Studies have suggested that hyperinsulinemia could be a potential cause of leptin resistance and hence obesity, eventually leading to metabolic syndrome in such individuals. When you gain weight, you increase your risk of insulin resistance, and then you will lead to leptin resistance. When a person has gained weight, biochemically speaking, hormonally speaking, metabolically speaking, a person that is overweight never ever is hungry. Let me repeat that. The first thing you need to understand, actually the next thing that you need to understand with leptin resistance, is that you don't ever have an appetite. If you're overweight, you're leptin resistant. Sorry, like it's just what it shows. You can look at BMI, body mass index. I don't like that scale. But when your BMI goes up higher, so does your leptin. So when your BMI goes up higher, your weight gets bigger. You gain weight. When people gain weight, their leptin goes up. They get leptin resistance. You don't have an appetite, ever. I could measure your blood work because I measure leptin. I measure fasting insulin. I measure fasting leptin in blood work. They both need to be below 10. Okay, fasting insulin and leptin need to be below 10. If I check your labs and they're above 10, especially leptin, I'm like, you don't have an appetite ever. And the more weight you gain, the less of an appetite you ever have. And this is a very difficult conversation to have with people sometime because food addiction gets brought up. So I deal with weight loss. That's what I'm really good at. And that's how I discovered leptin resistance. I started ordering leptin on every single client in here, especially the ones who were having struggles losing weight. And I found that they had insulin resistance. Their blood sugar was normal, right? Fasting blood sugar, A1C, like that. Everyone says, oh, my doctor says my sugar is fine. Okay, well, that's another conversation. But yeah, let's say your insulin or your blood sugar is fine. What about your fasting insulin? Because fasting insulin can be spiked with just a meal, right? So imagine you ate a fatty meal before you did your blood work, your insulin's going to be high. So I always have people fast before they come into their blood work. So imagine I say, don't eat anything the day of your blood work, 8 to 10, 12 hours if you can, last meal. Their insulin is still high whenever I check their labs, and so is their leptin. And I'm like, wow, like, why is that high? And, well, I don't know. I was like, you're kind of insulin resistant and leptin resistant, but yet you're a 28, 38, year old female or male, and you put on 5 or 10, 20 pounds. You can't lose. You're like, yeah, I can't lose the 5 or 10, 20 pounds here in my belly. I've tried working out harder. I tried changing my diet. And I said, what if you just don't eat? And you said, what do you mean? I said, well, how about this? Let me rephrase the question. How about you eat when you're hungry? And then they look at me crazy, like, well, I'm always hungry. No, you're not. Because according to your labs, your leptin is at 44. It's super high. The cutoff is 10. When you go above 10, you have what's called leptin resistance. And leptin resistance means you don't have an appetite ever. So why, again, do you say that you're hungry all the time? That's when the conversation can go one or two ways, right? I'm not trying to call someone out, but I am. Right? Because when you come to me for weight loss, this is usually what I hear. I hear this 4, 5, 6 times a day. And on online, all the messages and comments, I need help losing weight. I went into menopause. I need help losing weight. I have my gallbladder taken out. I can't lose weight. I have gut issues. I can't lose weight. I have a fatty liver. I can't lose weight. I'm 30 years old. I can't lose weight. What's going on? If I check leptin on every single one of them and it was high, that's the reason why you can't lose weight. Because you keep eating when you're not even hungry. Leptin resistance means you do not have an appetite ever. And if it's higher when I check your blood work, then I'm thinking your body's still telling you that you're full, even though you haven't eaten a meal in 12 hours. Why are you going to eat lunch as soon as we get the blood drawn? Oh, it's because I'm hungry. I'm like, no, you're not. Biochemically speaking, you have high leptin. You are not hungry at this moment, even though you think you are. Your blood sugar is dropping is the problem. And they're going to say, yeah, I'm hangry. Ah, that's the big difference. If your blood sugar drops, people get hangry. There's no way that someone who has blood sugar problems can not eat for 3 or 4 hours. Trust me, I've seen these diabetics. Like, they cannot go 3 or 4 hours. They have a blood glucose reader, and they're measuring their blood glucose consistently. They have to be at a certain range. When the blood sugar drops, all right, there's a problem. They have to eat something and get the blood sugar back up to an optimal range, right? No one is talking about the leptin in this scenario. Okay, when you talk about weight gain, okay, let's go to Ozempic. Let's just go to Ozempic real quick. The reason why the Ozempic is not working as well as it could, the semaglutide is not working as well as it could, it's because you're still leptin resistant. Ozempic is a diabetes drug. It helps insulin resistance. Okay, by default, it might help leptin, but I'm going to guarantee you this. If you don't change your diet completely while you're taking Ozempic, you will still have leptin resistance, which means you still have no appetite. This is what's also fascinating. You know what one of the side effects of Ozempic is besides weight loss? Because that is a side effect. It's supposed to control insulin. That's why it helps you with weight loss. You have a problem with your insulin. That's why you gain weight, right? Ozempic suppresses your appetite. It's a GLP-1 agonist. That's the medication class. It's a peptide that comes in the gut. That's what GLP-1s are. GLP-1s are this classification of neuropeptides, very similar to what leptin is. Leptin is a neuropeptide, an adipokine that comes from your fat cells. And what leptin does, along with GLP-1s, it goes to your brain and it suppresses your appetite after meals. And what they have found in medicine is that if they inject you with that same peptide, that same neuropeptide, it's going to suppress your appetite, and it's also going to help you lose weight, and it's also going to help you control your insulin. Maybe in the future, they'll say Ozempic also indirectly helps with leptin resistance, but a lot of people take Ozempic and they don't change their diet. They think the Ozempic is going to do everything for them, because Ozempic literally suppresses your appetite to the point where now they say, I don't have to eat as much. That was the problem all along. I was eating too much. That is actually the problem. The problem in weight gain usually is you're eating too much. And you say, well, that can't be. I'm eating super healthy. I'm like, are you even hungry? Well, I don't know. Well, at dinner time, if you're leptin resistant, you're not hungry at dinner. If you're leptin resistant, you're not even hungry at breakfast. You might be hungry in the middle of the day when your blood sugar goes up and down. And that's when you catch it the right time. That's when you eat. Think about it. If you're leptin resistant, you show up to the Mexican restaurant at dinner time. At the end of a day of all cortisol and blood sugar and insulin going up and down, you consuming things, caffeine. At the end of the day, if your leptin's high and you've gained weight, especially if you are overweight and you're going out to eat at dinner, and this is for anyone right now who's gained weight, like you've gained 10 more pounds than you should. I'm not picking on you. I'm just stating the facts. If you've gained any weight, and your BMI's gone up at all, and you're classified and being overweight, your leptin's increased. Which means when you show up to the restaurant on Friday night, you're not hungry before you're about to eat your food. So when you order that food, because I know you're leptin resistant, I can then say, why are you about to eat this big meal that's too big for you? It's too big of a portion size. You're not even hungry. Like chemically speaking, you are not hungry when you're about to eat this enchilada plate. Why are you going to consume it on a Friday night? The answer always is because it makes me feel good. And that's why we talk about food addiction. If a person is overweight and they are struggling, trying to lose weight, and they're struggling with food because they are emotionally connected to food, there's a bigger discussion to be had. And my consults have really gone this way because of leptin. Look, if you want more clarification on leptin, here it is. Leptin causes inflammation in the body. Leptin calcifies your arteries. Leptin causes inflammatory markers like C-reactive protein to go up in your body. Okay? Leptin also suppresses a really good hormone from your fat cells called adiponectin, which adiponectin comes and actually protects you against diabetes and heart disease and dementia. But people who gain weight increase their production of leptin from their fat cells, that then suppresses things like adiponectin. Leptin and insulin are best friends, okay? Like if insulin hangs out, leptin's hanging out. So if insulin's not hanging out and you're insulin sensitive, guess what? You're leptin sensitive. When people are insulin sensitive, they have an appetite. When people are insulin resistant, they don't have an appetite. They think they have an appetite, but they have leptin resistance. They don't have an appetite. And that's where the confusion happens in your metabolism, because if you go eat a meal and you're not hungry, I'm going to say, where are you going to put it? Because let's just look at the Friday night scenario, right? I pick Friday night because this is when people cheat on their diet. Even people who are taking Ozempic, paying $400 a month maybe for this weight loss injection, they still go to the Mexican restaurant on Friday night and order the enchiladas and the margaritas, knowing they're not hungry because they're on Ozempic. It kills their appetite. And then they eat it because, oh, it just tastes so good. What they're really saying is, I deserve this meal. What do you deserve about this meal? What do you deserve about a margarita? What do you deserve about an enchilada plate that is too big for your stomach? I deserve it because I've had a stressful week, and this is the only thing that makes me feel good at the end of a stressful week. This is why we're addicted to chocolate. This is why we're addicted to nicotine. This is why we're addicted to alcohol. One of the other things that you need to understand about leptin resistance is that it affects your dopamine. Let's talk about your mood real quick. Leptin resistance causes low dopamine production. I will repeat that. When you have insulin resistance, you're starting to gain weight, you're starting to have become a pre-diabetic, and you're causing inflammation. You're also developing leptin resistance, which is a hormone coming from your fat cells that's telling you to stop eating. And while you're developing insulin resistance and leptin resistance, if you keep eating and you miss all these signals, all of this directly suppresses your dopamine. What they have shown is that leptin directly affects the dopamine circuits in the brain that are directly related to the reward pathways. When you have high amounts of leptin, it breaks up and distorts the reward pathways in our brain. And what happens is we change the approach that we have to food, because now we start looking at things that are going to increase that dopamine that we're missing. Okay, so imagine I eat sugar. Sugar goes up, increases my insulin, increases my leptin. That decreases my dopamine. Blood sugar goes up, insulin goes up, leptin goes up, dopamine goes down. Now, the problem in this scenario is that the person is gaining weight and they think they're hungry all the time, and they're inflamed. And they keep doing this every day. Essentially, this is the typical American. The typical American, 1 in 3 people are pre-diabetic, insulin resistant in this country, which means 1 in 3 people are leptin resistant, which means 1 in 3 people in this country are depressed. If your dopamine is low, you are depressed. You are apathetic. You are not motivated. You have no pleasure in life. That's what dopamine does for you. When your dopamine is really low, life sucks. When your dopamine is really high, life's good. Let's take Adderall, for example. Adderall is an ADHD medication that does what? It stimulates dopamine. When your dopamine is sky high, you're focused, you're motivated, you can stay on task, and you can accomplish all your work. When your dopamine drops like it does in ADHD, you're dysfunctional, you're distracted, you're lacking motivation or reward. Sound familiar? Your dopamine is a hormone, okay? It's a neurohormone, just like leptin. And what it does is it goes up and down based off your diet and your lifestyle. If you're stressed, you're stressing your body and you have to respond. Food is a stress on the body. So then your body responds by increasing the insulin and increasing the leptin to tell you to stop putting in more food in your body that you have to metabolize, digest, and store. Whenever this is happening, all of this, the insulin resistance, the leptin resistance, it's suppressing your dopamine. When people eat chocolate, it increases their dopamine. When you eat your favorite salty, crunchy potato chip, it increases your dopamine in your brain and your gut too, because most of your dopamine comes from your gut. But when you increase your dopamine, you get little dopamine hits every time you bite into a chocolate, every time you bite into your favorite dessert, every time you bite into your favorite taco, you get little dopamine hits. And when you get those little dopamine hits, you feel good and you're motivated and you're focused and you can accomplish anything. When you drink alcohol, alcohol increases your dopamine a little bit too. Sex will also increase your dopamine a little bit too. Promiscuous things like maybe, jumping off a cliff, gambling, all dopamine hits, right? And so if you think about what we're really addicted to, we're not addicted to sugar. We're not even addicted to the potato chips. We're addicted from the way the chocolate and the potato chips makes us feel. That is the strongest connection that you could possibly ask for in the body outside of your connection to your mom. Because your mom holding you in her arms makes you feel the same way as when you bite into that first chocolate chip cookie. It's the same reward pathway in the brain. Dopamine gets released whenever your mom hugs you or when you bite into a chocolate chip cookie. So if your mom's not there for you anymore, what do you think you're doing on Friday nights after a long, stressful week? You're sitting on the couch and eating a whole sleeve of chocolate chip cookies because that's the only thing you know that used to make you feel happy when you were a kid, when your mom bought you those cookies when you were 7. And you would sit there at the kitchen table eating the chocolate chip cookies with your mom, laughing and having a good time. And maybe it was before even your parents split up. And so you have this time frame in your mind when you're eating the chocolate chip cookies. It takes you back to when you were 7, before your parents split up, before the whole world came crumbling down, before you had responsibilities, when you were still innocent. And when you're 47 years old, and life is stressful, you and I both know the one thing that can make you feel like a kid again, that can make you feel safe, like your mom is hugging you in her arms, is to bite into that favorite chocolate chip cookie of yours. And the marketing companies and the food companies know it. That's why they attach things like Ronald McDonald's and Happy Meals and characters like Frozen and Pikachu on boxes for kids because they want an emotional connection to be attached to them from the earliest age possible. Because you and I know food is love, but food companies know food is money. And if I can get you to be addicted to our cookie at age 7, and I know that if I put your favorite cartoon character on that box at age 7, when you're age 47 and that same cartoon is revamped again in a new franchise model on TV and movies and your kids are watching it again, you'll have no problem buying the now new version of that chocolate chip cookie for you and your kids and taking a bite of it because that first bite brings you back once again to when you were a kid. We are not addicted to food. The human body will not run out of blood sugar. You can make your own. It's called gluconeogenesis. You store all the sugar you've ever consumed. You can even break down fat and turn it into sugar. You will not run out of sugar or blood glucose. You can eat way too much, which we do, leads to insulin resistance, leads to leptin resistance, messes with our appetite, causes weight gain, diabetes, fatty liver, leaky gut, heart disease, and dementia. All from the idea that our bodies are full and we're addicted to feeling good. And we will eat and drink and snort and shoot anything that makes us feel just as good as our mom's homemade chocolate chip cookies. I can ask anyone when we go out to eat, how was the tamales, especially Hispanic, right? How was the menudo? My dad's menudo is nothing compared to his mom's. He could make it to perfection. He could try every single bowl of menudo around the world and nothing's going to be as good as the one his mom made. There's no even contest because that was made with love. The food that you eat nowadays, there's no love behind it unless you make it yourself or a loved one made it for you. And quite honestly, if you're eating DoorDash, you have such a disconnect from the source of your food that you're emotionally eating food that's processed and brought to you in a packaged form. Most of the time we eat DoorDash and Uber Eats and Favor. You're eating it on the go. You're eating it on the run. You're eating it while you're standing up. You don't even care what you're eating. You're just, I just need to eat something. I have people that literally tell me, I missed breakfast and lunch. I feel like I have to make up for it, so I have to eat more in the future. No, that's not the case at all because of this thing called leptin resistance. Your body's telling you, put the fork down and listen. If you're hungry, eat. If you're not hungry, don't eat. And the problem is, like, I'm hungry all the time. That's probably not the case. But to bring this all home, if one in three people are insulin resistant, and one in three people are also leptin resistant, and one in three people also have low dopamine and depressed, and one in three people are overweight basically in this country, the good news is all of this can be reversed. Leptin resistance can be reversed. Insulin resistance can be reversed. Obesity can be reversed. Fatty liver disease can be reversed. Gut issues can be reversed. Like, how? Lifestyle. It's always lifestyle. It's always been lifestyle. Like, look at me. If I go to every medical textbook, they're going to say I am predetermined to be a diabetic just from the color of my skin and my genetics and my family history and the fact that I have a Z in my last name. No, I do not accept that. I do not accept that I have to wind up being sick as I get older. Every single nursing and medical health book says I'm at risk for being a diabetic. So you have to look at me, because especially I'm at the age of 40, I automatically am at risk for being a pre-diabetic because I'm over the age of 40. And because I'm Hispanic, double that risk. So every single day, knowing that diabetes and insulin resistance is the worst thing to develop, I live every day like I'm trying to prevent that, which means I'm trying to prevent leptin resistance every day. This is what I know to work. If you want to reverse leptin resistance, you want to bring your appetite back, you want to lose weight, you want to control your insulin better, you got to make brown fat. Remember that brown fat that was, or remember the fat that I was talking about around your belly? That same fat that makes the leptin, the same fat that increases whenever you gain weight. To lower leptin resistance, you got to reduce the inflammation in your fat cells. When you gain weight, your fat cells get bigger because they're inflamed. It's not like your foot got bigger, right? Because when you lose weight, it's not like your foot gets smaller in size. Your midsection gets smaller. When you control your blood sugar, your insulin, and your leptin, you control inflammation, you can actually lose weight. And the way you do all of this is you make brown fat. There's this term called thermogenesis. Thermogenesis is when white fat, inflamed white fat that makes leptin, white fat in thermogenesis, white fat heats up to brown. What you want to do is you want to brown your white fat. The way that you brown your white fat is thermogenesis. The way that you brown your white fat and reduce leptin resistance is thermogenesis. The way you promote thermogenesis is doing cold exposure, cold plunges, cryotherapy, put a little bowl with ice and water in it and dunk your face in it. I got done telling the team here that this last couple weekends I did a fantasy football draft and I brought a cold plunge for all the guys, and I had 12 guys doing a cold plunge. Never done cold plunges before. Never, like, they weren't scared. You can't be scared in front of 12 guys. You got to jump in. I know it's painful. Trust me. But they were smiling while they were doing the cold plunge. And not only that, there's a hot tub right next to it. So they were jumping in and out, going hot to cold, hot to cold. And I said, you're going to feel amazing after this. And they all looked at me like I was crazy. Almost like, how could I feel better after putting myself through a bunch of torture, like sitting through a 3 minutes of an ice plunge? I told them, I said, you're going to heat up your brown fat, or heat up your fat, turn it brown. It reduces leptin, helps improve your appetite, increases your energy, controls your insulin. You're going to lose weight. They said, after just doing one cold plunge? I said, yeah. Literally, one cold plunge starts to reverse the inflammation pathways. It starts to brown your white fat cells and starts to lower your leptin after just one cold plunge. So if you imagine you do one cold plunge a month for a year, you're going to lower your leptin. If you do one cold plunge a week, you're going to lower your leptin. If you do one cold plunge a week, not only will you lower your leptin, you'll improve your dopamine, you'll also improve your focus. The science, besides you know, increasing your insulin sensitivity and lowering your leptin with cold exposure, it shows here that cold exposure also, let me see if I put it right here. I had it here where it shows here that cold exposure will also help promote norepinephrine. That's what I was looking for. Here it is. When you do a cold plunge, you don't actually increase the dopamine that way. What you do is you increase your norepinephrine. So you get a rush of adrenaline, basically, because norepinephrine turns into adrenaline. So one of the things that the guys felt when they were doing the cold plunge is that they actually would feel really happy because the body was stressed when you were sitting in the cold. But what it does is it increases your norepinephrine and your endorphins, which is a painkiller. So they're literally having natural pain inflammation, natural painkillers, and natural anti-inflammatories with the cold plunge while they're sitting there breathing it out, adjusting to it, and then they're shivering, which heats up their fat cells, lowers the leptin, and regulates the insulin, and it helps them with inflammation, weight, and digestion, all from just doing one cold plunge. And if the more you do, the healthier you get. Not even joking. And it's no coincidental that when we gain weight, we never get cold or shiver because, quite frankly, people who are overweight don't want to be cold. But you should. You need to shiver. And if you can't do the cold plunge, go walk into Costco or Sam's in the freezer section, roll up your sleeves, lift your shirt up to your, you know, stomach, and walk around until you get shiver, until you start to get cold. And if it's 30 seconds, you start chattering your teeth, you did it. Because all you need to do is shiver. It doesn't have to be 3 minutes. It can be 30 seconds. You just need to shiver. But the science has shown it helps you with leptin. And let's say you want to take it up a notch. Not only do you start doing the cold therapy to reverse your leptin, you add berberine. My favorite supplement at the moment is our Berberine Plus by MSW Nutrition. Use code NURSEDOZA for a discount. This is what you do with berberine. Berberine literally lowers leptin. Okay, there's a study here that says after 3 months of treatment, metabolic syndrome patients, which are insulin resistant patients as well as leptin resistant, showed decreases in their BMI and leptin levels as well as insulin resistance after 3 months of treatment with berberine. These results suggest that berberine improves insulin sensitivity by inhibiting fat store and adjusting adipokines, which is the leptin, in human pre-adipocytes and metabolic syndrome patients. Basically, what they're saying is berberine helps lower leptin. And if you do that, plus you change your diet, plus you do cold plunges or cold exposure, you're going to make brown fat, you're going to control your insulin, you're going to reduce inflammation, and guess what? You're going to lose weight. There's even a study here that's in the show notes if you want to see this. The study is titled, Acute Cold Exposure Decreases Plasma Leptin in Women. Leptin is different in women. It's higher than it is in men, but it had these women doing cold exposure, and they said, "Here, this is what I was looking for." It says, after 30, 60, and 90 minutes of cold exposure, these women had increased norepinephrine, decreased leptin, and they said that they felt great afterwards. Just as a side note. You can go read the study for yourself. Are you convinced? Think about this. We've talked about weight loss, weight gain. We've talked about insulin resistance. We've talked about diabetes. We've talked about heart disease. We've talked about gut issues. We've talked about liver disease. We've talked about, you want to talk about gallbladder? It's all involved in there too. You want to talk about hormonal issues, PCOS? We mentioned it too. If you're looking at wanting to lose weight, work on your leptin. Cold exposure, take berberine, right? Eat when you're actually hungry. Be aware of that, right? All of these things can be controlled. I can't eat for you. Like, that's the thing. I put the ball in your court because I'm challenging you, because the whole reason you stumbled upon this podcast is because you want to be better. You want to feel better. You want to lose the weight. I don't care. Call it weight loss. If you want to lose 100 pounds, it's not going to happen in 30 days. If you follow this recipe that we just talked about, you could lose 100 pounds in about a year and a half. How bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? You can do this. We've all done it. I lost 50 pounds doing it this way, and I'm still working on maintaining and keeping it off. This is the best I've ever felt. I'm 42 years old. You can feel better as you get older. You deserve it. Until next time, keep working on your health. Class is concluded.